Hello, teachers. I hope you can all hear me. Welcome to this third session, Communication Skills, Grade 6, 7, and 8, the culmination of the three series webinar series on communication skills on our communication skills syllabus done by Dale Edwards. So this is the final one, and I think it's the most complex, the high grades at the high grades. So I'm going to send you straight over to Dale because I think we have a lot to cover, Dale. Welcome back, Dale.
Thank you, Ray. Good afternoon, teachers, and thank you for joining us this Saturday afternoon. So I'm going to very quickly share with you a couple of links to the earlier webinars that's in the chat right now. If you'd like to ever catch up on that, in case you missed the earlier ones, which was, in which we covered grades initial to 3 and grades 4 and 5. Today, of course, we look at a completely new level of complexity, but just to give you a quick catch up, if you are joining us for the first time, in the very first webinar, that's what we looked at, where we spoke of and don't mind the date. That date is because we did this first a little earlier in the year. And we spoke about the needed importance of communication skills in the syllabus score, and of course, then the relevant grades. And then we did this one, which essentially built up on the earlier one, but spent more time talking about grades 4 and 5. But in today's webinar, what I thought I'd like to do, because I was looking at some of your feedback and some of your thoughts, you'd requested that we spend more time on the tasks. So I thought we'd do that today, as well as maybe give you a little more time to ask some questions, since we're covering 3 grades together, and also they're the 3 significantly higher grades. Now, what you should have with you, and I'm just sharing this link with you, is a copy of the digital syllabus, and that's from where you can get it if you want to download it now. So there are 2 documents that you need to download. You need to download the communication skills syllabus, and that's the green one on the left-hand side. And you need to also download the support guide, which is specifically intended for grades 6, 7, and 8. And if someone is still doing the professional certificate, just let you know it's still valid till the 31st of July. But under the circumstances, we're not so sure whether we could stage that exam. Nonetheless, grades 6, 7, and 8 are still valid and will always hold good. Now, this is, today I'm gonna deep dive straight into the grades and not talk so much about the importance of communication skills or the syllabus. Needless to say, all of that information is always available. Just to let you know that there's one key slide that you really should look at. And if you wanna click a quick screenshot, then this is the one to click, which tells you how to read the syllabus and talks about the very different page numbers that have relevance to your teaching, your learning outcomes, the assessment criteria, the attainment bands, the recognition and relevance, and of course, most importantly, the 21st century skills that we keep referring to. So that's all I'm gonna say about this, the syllabus this time round, and dive straight into the grades. Now, today, when we look at grades 6, 7, and 8, I must point out that it's quite a big qualitative as well as quantitative jump from grades initial to 5. And I say this because grades initial to 5 tend to focus more about you and your communication skills from a projection outward. But grades 6, 7, and 8 take that to a whole new meaning. Not only will you be doing some more challenging and some more sophisticated communication, but you will also start to be looking at communication in the context of how is it happening to you and the world around us and how we are impacted by communication and so on and so forth. So hence I've put up this particular visual representation, which was first brought to light by a gentleman called Edward T. Hall, where he basically spoke of the the concept of culture. And he says, we see all these things happening around us in the context of culture, from cooking to literature to music and the fine arts, but they did not happen overnight. And they're not, they are actually built up over a period of time, pretty much the way an iceberg, we see just the tip of it. In much the same way, the entire base below the water is what goes into forming it and bringing it up to that level. And the same logic or the same model can be applied to competencies that we develop as social beings. So you see that the world around us, we tend to say, oh, this person is very well informed, has good knowledge, some great skills, but that's just above the surface. What is below the surface is a lot of things that are going on in the background, from motives to traits to self-image and the social role, that all of these things work in conjunction to shape those skills and knowledge. So as you approach to understand grade 6, 7, and 8, and more importantly, start to teach it, you must give it a little bit of time to understand, for the participant or for the candidate to understand that it's going to require a very, very strong foundation. So hence, it's important to go back a little bit and look at some of our earlier grades, particularly topics that deal with one's own growth in the area of communication, starting with intrapersonal communication, which is the rooting of all ideas to be either a belief, a value, and an attitude, and what the world perceives out of that. And from then onwards, to build the skill sets and the awareness of various aspects of the communication process. So just to help you put things in perspective, these are basically the learning outcomes of grades 6, 7, and 8. So what you see in the dark, almost very indigo kind of ink, is basically the learning outcomes of grade 6. And then you see over 7 and 8, I've highlighted them in blue to show how they progressively increase in one's ownership of material, in one's understanding of the subject, in one's authority with which they communicate, and certainly in regards as awareness of the construct in which this communication is happening. So please have a look at these particular learning outcomes. It can be found in the earlier parts of the syllabus. All the learning outcomes from grades initial to 8 are all mentioned one below the other. So that brings us into a grade 6. And I wanted to just highlight this because one of the comments that I saw was, how do we distinguish, or how does one assess what is a candidate doing or how well they're doing it? So I thought I'd try and give it to you in one sample slide, and that too just in one specific instance, but you can do this on your own, and I'd like to show you how you could do it. So this is a grade 6 exam, and these are the 3 tasks that you have. Now, I am talking about the tasks a little later, but what I'd like to draw your attention to is the attainment descriptors and what creates the distinction between each of those 4 bands. So for instance, if you look at point 1 under distinction, I've highlighted the in yellow and in pink, I've highlighted the criteria. So you will see it, the yellow criteria talks about verbal and nonverbal skills. So that's one way of us assessing it, whether it's in distinction, merit, pass, or below pass. Now, the words that we would use in the context of verbal and nonverbal skills was, for instance, if you were very good, we would say there was a synthesis of wide-ranging verbal and nonverbal skills. And because of that, you would get a distinction. On the other hand, if there wasn't this synthesis, but there was a wide variety of integrated verbal and nonverbal skills, it would match the criteria of merit. But if you move one rung lower, and that is to pass, we would say there was just a range. And finally, if you look at below pass, we would say there was little or no range. So you see, it's these wordings, and this is why examination reports become so important, because these words is what you would find typically written. So just remember, they're like shades of gray, all right, along with the criteria. Similarly, I've highlighted another criteria, which is develop their own ideas, including their rationale. Now, that you can see is highlighted in pink across all the four bands. And I've created this distinction by showing you that in the case of distinction and merit, you must have some confidence in being able to express and develop your own ideas. Whereas in the case of pass, it says there is only some confidence. All right, so you can see it's a very small word, but creates a big distinction. So when you, and of course, when you look at the last category or below pass, it says there was limited ability to organize and develop ideas. So this wording is how you should probably create your reference when you're working with learners. So to give you an example, when we work with learners, particularly when it comes to developing skills, and this was a theory which was first purported by Stanford in 1963, which said that skills can be broken down, or the teaching of skills could be broken down in much the same way we teach motor skills. So you can break them up into small compartments and then work on that. So stretching from that, typically when you work with in a lesson plan, you need to kind of ensure that you have these four stages in your lesson, all right? One is presentation, or what we call elicitation. And this is where the teacher is explaining. This could happen for maybe 5, 7 minutes, 10 minutes, depending on what you're teaching. And thereafter, the candidate gets a chance to have controlled practice. So they do this with your guidance. And with your appropriate feedback, they then come to the production stage. So wherein now they have a chance to practice this a little more freely, because one, they've seen you do it in the presentation stage. They've thereafter had a chance to practice, receive feedback, and now they're getting into the production stage, which is freer practice. And then finally, of course, over doing it for some period of time, they will start to personalize it and own that particular task. So I hope you understand that typically this process, depending on how complex your learning outcome is for that lesson, can your lesson plan should go through these four phases, either in that one lesson, or if you're splitting that learning outcome over two lessons, then you need to cover these four phases typically in those two phases or in those two lessons. So this is just another ready reckoner to help you. If you take all the learning outcomes and the assessment criteria and plot it one below the other on the left-hand side, and then if you as a teacher look and see, okay, in lesson plan one, did I cover this aspect of vocal variety, or did we look at body language? Maybe you haven't. And then maybe in lesson plan two, you may. So you can sit and do this across the entire spectrum of your lesson plans to ensure that all your outcomes are being met. And you can even see with what level of frequency and regularity you're doing, or you're circling back to your learning outcomes, or which lesson plans have it. Which brings me to, of course, to even when you're working towards developing students for assessments, you may want to do the same thing, except that here, for each of the parameters or the metrics, you could look at the wording associated with it to know whether the candidate is consistently performing in a distinction zone or in a merit zone or needs more help and so on. So this is just an easier way to keep it all together. Which brings us to grade six task one. So this is grade six task one. Essentially, it's a presentation in which we are assessing four skills: communication, interaction, analysis, and performance. This is a presentation is always considered very formal, all right? So you stand for this task. You could use audiovisual aids. And at this level, I think it might be of great help, although it's not a must. Okay, I want to clarify that too. Now, here you see that a candidate delivers a presentation or an idea for either a business enterprise, a social event, or a creative endeavor. Now, just for your ease, I have taken all the three examples, all right? And I've tried to give you, firstly, what would be the definition of a business enterprise, what could be likely examples, and what would be your talking points. So when the candidate starts this particular task, they have to define who their audience is, and it must be at least 20 people. But you realize that when you've got talking about a business enterprise and you're talking about, for instance, what's the business, the kind of market research, the opportunity, the product, the unique proposition, et cetera, this is when you will actually have your 5 minutes will seem very little. So you may actually need to eliminate certain elements of what you'd like to cover. Now, I'm going to stop sharing over here because I'd like to share with you an actual sample of an exam task. In fact, this was actually done by my daughter a few years ago when she was actually doing a grade six. Just give me a second, please. So there you go. So I'm going to keep it in this mode so I can also see it while I'm talking to you about it. So in this particular case, my daughter decided to talk about creating some sort of a creative endeavor, which was also like a business enterprise, but it was not to make money. It was more as a not-for-profit kind of initiative. So she spoke about making an appeal to the Center for the Performance of the Arts. Her audience was key management in an organization because that particular organization employs close to about 4,000 or 5,000 people in the area in which we live. And a lot of that staff were people who were not even in the regular management, or they were just basically all I would put it as the not so important kind of jobs, and which required more of physical labor and physical hours, from the janitorial staff and the housekeeping staff of this organization. So she made this appeal to the organization saying, why not we create a center for the performance of the arts, and it could be a corporate social responsibility initiative, which is powered by your funds, which goes towards taking care of these children. So just to talk you through what she spoke about. So she spoke about the vision for this particular center. And she said it's about taking care of our children's future and teaching children to excel through art and performance. Then of course she gave a little bit of a background as to what she wanted to cover while talking to them. So she spoke about why am I doing this, where am I coming from, a little bit about the details of the appeal and what goes into making it happen, and so on. So she started with why the need for an appeal like this. So one, personally, I think it's good if we give back. Two is I as part of character formation, I think it's good when young people are engaged in learning how to give back. And then, of course, she went on to make the logical point to say, I think it's a great way for you as an organization to care for your employees' well-being. It's also a great way to impart non-formal, engaging after-school activity for your employees' children. And most importantly, it keeps children happy. She then, of course, shared her perspective of currently what she's doing and how, through the exposure she's had over the years, feels so much more empowered because of performance and arts. And hence she says, I think I'd like to be able to do this for other children where I'm young, so I don't have the money, but I have the energy and I have the knowledge, and we will get in the right people to do it. So she then went on to define that where would this place run? So she spoke about a particular place in Bombay and said that this is a community library. There are about 5,000 disadvantaged children in the area. And there are 5 rooms in this municipal library, which is being offered at a very notional rent. And she wanted to take this over to make this place viable, happy, and a place for learning. And then of course she went out to define what she wants to do and for who. So she wanted to do drama and communication, painting and drawing, music and teaching English. And within each subject, she laid out all the other items that she wanted to talk about. And then spoke a little bit about how this would operate. So it would happen 6 days a week for an hour of each lesson. The frequency of the lesson would be once a week, 25 children per batch, and it would operate between 4 to 8 p.m. in the evening. And this was a little bit of the financial snapshot that she enclosed, where she said the total cost, if the organization was able to donate 1,000 rupees per child, all right, and they could only take care of 600 children, all right, that would cost about 7.2 million rupees. And against that, this is how she would purportedly spend the money, including giving things like basic supplies and milk and so on. So, and then of course she ended by saying, so why is this appeal important? Because in return for the 1,000 rupees that you put aside for the child, one, you're doing the right thing. Two, you're bettering a child's life. Three, you're taking care of your employees. All right. And if you do that, then what more can you really ask for in terms of loyalty? And most importantly, you're doing charity or you're helping someone, but you know the beneficiary directly. And finally, of course, if that isn't all enough, you'll even get a tax break because these are funds allocated for social work. So she covered all of this in the course of 5 minutes. So I'm sharing this with you just as an example, and I want to try and give you examples for all the tasks today. So please bear with me. This might go a little over 4 o'clock, but I will try and keep this as quick as possible. So coming back to what we were talking about, I'm going to share my screen again now. So hence that was an example of, for instance, a creative endeavor combined with a business enterprise. Now you can keep this purely to a business enterprise, which is why you will see some of the talking points that I spoke about over there involved what's the offering, what's the market research, there were 5,000 children, what is she going to do? So she was going to offer drama and language and so on. The unique proposition, of course, over here, it was a CSR initiative. But if you were starting, let's say, a bakery or a cooking class or something like that, then how would you distinguish yourself from your competition? A little bit about the location, the infrastructure, the marketing, operations, and the financials and viability. If you were talking about a social event, you could talk about what's the event, what's the cause. And of course, the definition of social event could be anything from a picnic to a seminar to a birthday to a family engagement to whatever you want. Creative endeavor. Okay, again, very wide by definition, but essentially something that refers to one having the ability or power to create, characterized by originality of thought. So it could be metalworks, it could be an art studio, it could be a design studio, and so on. So that's grade 6 task 1. Now, in the light of this, because you're talking about defining your audience of 20 people, I wanted to put in a note on how does one describe or how does one categorize an audience, or how do you define your audience? So, or how do you prepare for your task, keeping in mind your audience? So one thing, of course, is to look at the audience in terms of the demographics, all right? Age, religion, what is common among them, their socioeconomic background, the educational background, the political leanings. I don't talk about political leanings because you're going to make a political speech, but because invariably some element of political leanings do creep into normal everyday thoughts. So being aware of that is important in being able to understand what's your no-go area. Similarly, in addition to understanding your audience, you must also understand the speaking situation, as in why is the audience there? Is the audience there out of force and compulsion, or is the audience volunteered to be there out of choice? Then, of course, the audience disposition towards the topic. So does the audience coming over there like you, but not the topic? Or they feel good about the topic, and hence the fourth point, they also feel good about you. So these are 4 things to consider in audience analysis, because I suspect when you work with children and learners, you need to also teach them what audience is and how to analyze your audience. Which brings us to, this of course is just a rough exercise. We could do this, but we don't, in the interest of time, I won't. Is, for instance, at a school reunion, what do you believe would be the common elements of the audience? So obviously they would all be of a common age, presumably of a similar cultural background, of a similar educational background, of an even similar socioeconomic background, and so on. So you can see that this is just an exercise. It will be there, of course, when you see the recording, so you can look at it a little later. Which brings me, of course, now to grade six, task two. So this is a task where the candidate presents a prepared CV or a curriculum vitae for a job or training course or an opportunity. Now, in the case of the digital assessments, you do not have to prepare a physical CV. But in the case of an in-person face-to-face exam, you would prepare a CV. So let's talk, since we're not really offering the in-person exams right now, let's talk about the digital option only. Now, in a scenario like this, it's important for you to kind of get together all your information, all right, and be aware of it. So what all goes into a CV, all right? And then you start off this task by explaining to the examiner that this is the opportunity or the role that I'm looking for or the course I'm seeking admission into. And I would like you to play this particular role, either as that of the head of department or as the principal or as the managing director of a company and so on. And typically what you should try and cover in your CV are these components. So the personal details, which have all the full name, the in contact information, a summary and an objective, but it should also have all the educational and professional courses that you may have been a part of, your experience from internships to apprenticeships to various roles and responsibilities, and of course your skills and certificates, things that are measured in more ways than just academic marks, but could be done through your trajectory of promotions and the kind of skills or job functions that you performed along the way, and even various upskilling opportunities that you took part in. So this is typically what you would put into a CV. Now comes the part of negotiating the interview process. So I've kind of outlined how you would prepare for this. So step one, preparing for an interview requires you to be astute, alert, patient, and reflective. So once you are composed, you then be aware of the stages of an interview. So when you get in, it's usually the introductions, the small talk, which we learn in grade 1, 2, and 3 of communication skills. Then it's the information gathering stage where tell me about this or where have you been and so on and so forth. And then comes very specific things like question and answer. And it finally leads with a wrap up and the next steps. Now, this is, I think, is important. That's why I'm sharing it with you. What are the possible questions that could come up in an interview? And of course, apart from the obvious ones, there could be some tricky ones. For instance, what are your expectations? Financial expectations, always a difficult one when the ball is in your court. How much would you like to be paid or compensated? Or why would you consider yourself the better candidate than the other 300 outside the door? So handling, task handling, and how to work through these skillfully is what you as teachers need to be able to work through with your students to better prepare them. Which brings me, of course, to grade six, task three. And over here we see the candidate discusses with the examiner the content and delivery of the text of a speech. Now, in the face-to-face exam, the speech is given to you 15 minutes prior. But in the case of the online exam, you actually already have the speech. And that is where you can access that in the support guide. That's why I gave you the link to download not just the syllabus, but the support guide as well. So over there, you would see that there are three speeches that are given. Now, you need to prepare all the three speeches, the analysis of all the three speeches, and the examiner will choose one of them. So it kind of keeps it a little bit fresh. You're not studying it by heart. And indeed, this is an analysis or a discussion with the examiner on the text that is provided. So when it comes to analyzing a speech, what are the things that one should look at? Obviously, you start with, what is the speech all about? So when you look at it from a subject perspective, you want to talk about what is the speech all about? What are the main points? What are the keywords? What is the language being used? How is it structured? What are the transitions? Are we moving from one para to the next para? Similarly, what is the intent of the speech? Remember, all communication falls into one of three buckets, okay? It could either be to inform or to educate, or it could be to entertain or to relate to you in some way, or it could be to persuade you. And chances are many complex or many good speeches have a mix of all. So you should be very clear in eliciting whether which were the components that it had and which one was the leading component over there, hence what was the speech all about. Similarly, who do you think this speech is targeted at? So for instance, if it's a speech on, let's say, nuclear disarmament, you'd understand that it's not a speech for a common man or an everyday audience, particularly if it was persuasive in nature. It would be more for policymakers and decision makers and the armed forces to discuss something like that. But let's say a speech about what's happening around us, a topic like Black Lives Matter or social injustices, then it could be for a far wider defined audience. So you need to specify that. Similarly, you then need to put yourself in the speaker's shoes and say, well, if I was delivering this speech, I would probably put a pause over here, or I would emphasize these words a little bit more, or my pace over here would be a little more racy because I'm kind of mounting a charge. And of course, in moments of sadness, I'd probably intone my voice a little bit and so on. And similarly, what kind of physical skills and audiovisual aids would you bring to the table if you were making the speech? So it's more about this particular task is there is no one right or wrong answer. It's more about firstly, you developing the sensibilities around what happens in speeches and you being able to understand or read between the lines, literally pun intended. So this way you now understand that communication is not just about you standing and talking eloquently, but it's about you being reactive. It's about you pausing, thinking, looking at how others also crafted their messages and so on. So this is an example of a speech. It might be a little too small for you to see, so I won't tax your eye, but I can tell you where you'd find the speech. So the best place, by the way, to work with good resources is to get into TED Talks. Go to the transcript section of every TED Talk and you'll get the full speech verbatim. And then in that context, use the parameters that I've put out on the left as an indication to analyze the speech. So exactly what I put in the earlier slide, I've kind of put it up all one below the other. And here you can paste speeches over here and work this with your class. All right, so this particular speech is, by the way, one of the most watched speeches. I'm sure you've all seen it by Sir Ken Robinson, the late Sir Ken Robinson, who's got close to 70 million views for the speech. All right, it's dry, it's witty, it's humorous, and yet it's so insightful into what education is today. Similarly, there will be other speeches and so on. So I'm not getting into that right now. I know we are not in workshop mode. So today is just about sharing some information with you. Now, grade 7 task 1. Here, a candidate gives a presentation on a social issue, all right, to an imagined defined audience. You should stand for this task. We are looking at communication, interaction, analysis, and performance, because after you make a presentation for 9 minutes, the examiner is going to talk to you about it for another 3 minutes to explore alternative points that you may have brought up. So you see, it's not just about working to a script and saying, did I get my speech right? It's about understanding other perspectives that when someone talks to you about it, you are also aware or you are also capable of adding into that conversation. So I've defined what is a social issue, all right? I've even given you a few examples, all right, on the screen. And by definition, normally social issues tend to also have a little bit of a follow through into an economic issue or a political issue, all right? So don't worry, I mean, these are all lines of gray actually over there. But I would just say it as, look at the bulk of the issue being around people and less about money or politics. So things like, for instance, climate change, okay, overpopulation, civil rights, gender inequality, education. Now, of course, you'd say all these things are also connected with money as well, but I agree with you, they are. So hence, the definition of social issue is, I would say, something that affects society, all right? Largely because it maybe is just the way things are or the practices that we follow or the lack of them. I want to share with you an example. In fact, this is again, This is a particular task, which again, my daughter did when she was in grade seven or did a grade seven exam. Let me see if I can pull that up for you. Give me a moment, please. Yep, there we are. Here you are. So again, this is her, she started off by defining who her audience is. So she said she is presenting to a group of fellow students between grades 8 and 12 in school, and it's their parent monthly teacher meet. She's a student council member. Her social issue is our overexposure to the digital world. The setting was a school hall with about 75 attendees. She was using audiovisual aids. She herself is dressed semi-formally, and she's talking for about 5 minutes. Now, her topic of choice was the digital era, and are we overexposed? So she started off with something like this. What's wrong with this picture? And then, of course, the obvious is there, which is it's an empty playground. Everything's intact, seesaw, swings, basketball court, but all the kids are sitting on the side, and they're too sitting. And they should be playing, and of course they are playing games. And then of course she talks about how did we get here. So she makes reference to a generation which was born pre-mobile phone, which is the baby boomers, and those born post-mobile phone, which is the mobile boomers, and then the migrants, which is presumably us parents and teachers who've seen the both worlds. And then she talks about how what is our approach to life? So the migrants, they started their day with an end their day with a prayer, whereas the mobile boomer is checking their social media status and updates. And of course, she used several parameters to highlight this, basically all about beliefs, values, attitudes, all right? And then of course, continue to explain this a little bit further. And then says, well, in the context of all of this, who is to blame? How did we reach this way? Are we the culprits? For the simple reason that the people who are actually behind all of this, including this gentleman that you see on the screen, who has made billions out of you and I using his product, is the first to caution his own children about not using social media and about going out and smelling roses and the flowers. And the same too, where she speaks about another gentleman who also believes in the same values for his family, but is happy to let you do what you want with your family. So then of course she talks about this is the time to act. So it's a persuasive speech, a call to action. And maybe first we should learn moderation. We should realize that the real world comes first. We should realize that it's more about we and less about I. And we should also look at de-addiction in this day and age. So this is a social issue that she chose to speak of. I'm going to stop sharing this again and go back to my earlier presentation. Sorry for all of this. Okay, something's wrong. Let me just try that again. All right. Okay, so that's grade seven, task one. Unfortunately, we're not discussing how to teach this, but we're just discussing what would happen in the task, which brings me to grade seven, task two. So here, of course, the candidate discusses with the examiner the content and delivery of an advertisement, the text of which is provided by the examiner 15 minutes before. That's in the case of a face-to-face exam. And if it's in the case of a digital exam, you already have those three advertisement scripts in your support guide. Now, what should you be discussing? Well, typically, you need to look at this. How do you analyze an advertisement? Starting with its audience. Who is the intended audience for this advertisement. What is the key language or key words that are being used? For instance, between, let's say, two different cola companies, one would choose to use language which is very different from the way the other one uses it. Or two auto companies or two chocolate companies or chocolatiers. So you need to look at the specific language that you think is attracting that audience. All right. It could be, in India's case, Hinglish words. All right. Then, of course, you need to look at the way the language and the sentence construct has been laid out. Is there a rhythmical meter or a rhythm to it, which makes it sound like a catchy tune? How is the copy laid out? All right. And by copy, I mean the actual wording of the advertisement copy, because that's what you will get in the support guide. So is it laid out in a particular way? Is it moving from "Hi, everybody," to "Come on, let's do it"? Or are they starting off with a question or a reflection and then a call to action? So things to look at. Then, of course, you need to see that kind of ad. How do you think it would be rendered? Better as a visual ad or better with audio? And if it is with audio, what kind of narrative should it have? What kind of voice should we use? Should we use a male voice, a female voice, a child's voice, an old person's voice? Should the voice be hard? Should the voice be fast? Should it be sensuous? Are we dealing with luxury? And so on. And then, of course, come the vocal dynamics. Okay, pretty much what you'd be teaching in speech and drama. Look at the pausing. All right. Is there an inflection? Is there a change in tone? And so on. And of course, because it's advertising, it could be whether you want any post-production effects, where you want some music in the background. And if it's music, what kind of music do you want? Do you want something like a Gregorian chant, or do you want something like urban rap? So, and if you do, why do you want it? So this is what you would be discussing in the context of an advertisement. So there's a couple of case studies just to work on. So you can see this is, we can do this in perhaps another time, where this is the copy of an ad, all right? And then, of course, you try and identify against this what should be the target gender, the recommended length of the ad, what kind of character or casting or voice should there be, and so on. So just that same ad, this is what it would look like, because it's appealing or it's got something to do with education. Perhaps the general norm, and I'm not saying it's the rule, is perhaps maybe to appeal to the woman in the house. Of course, that's not to discount what dads do also. But maybe that's perhaps normally something that's done in most households by ladies. And what kind of vocal direction should there be? It should be tactful, because you're appealing to a parent and saying, we can help your child who's maybe not developed in this area yet, which means that it must be put across tactfully. And so on. So this is just an example, right? Now, moving ahead, let's look at grade 7 task 3. So here you talk about, you are given, the examiner gives an overview of a social or a political issue, and the candidate expresses and explains their views on the situation. So you see, this is now about how do you respond, what is your communication to things happening around you. So I, of course, I've defined what a social or a political issue is, and I think there's no rocket science definition to that. But more importantly, I wanted to share with you, what is the objective? So the purpose of this task is to assess the candidate's ability to listen and quickly analyze a situation unfamiliar to them, and to clearly express their personal opinions and reasons for those. So how do you prepare for a task like this? Well, to start with, we'll go back to what we discussed in grade one. Is step one is when you have read that article or the examiner's put across the issue to you, you need to understand, where do you stand with this article? All right, what is your personal validity, or how do you validate this in terms of, is this good, right, wrong, bad? I'm not so sure, all right? Thereafter, you try and put it into the context of human feelings. So this is just a very simple list of human universal experiences that all of us have, irrespective of things like wealth or health or whatever. We all human beings experience these feelings, these relationships, these social structures. So in that article, what are they referring to? Are they referring to a social structure like this? All right, where they're talking maybe about, or they're talking about hate. And what is the world, what do we feel internally about hate? What is the world's view on hate? All right, what have we learned from times when there's been excessive hate? What is the opposite to hate? Will that be a better alternative? So we must learn to express all of these things in views. So, which leads us to, after you've gone through step two, is to develop step three, which is to put it into context of views. So when you are forming your views, how do you do that? So you listen to your gut instinct, you talk to others, you gather your facts, your figures, your research, you ask people what they think, you be willing to listen, hit the reset button if it's something that you think you may have missed, all right? And you don't always have to pick a side. I mean, you can agree to disagree. And then, of course, when it comes to expressing your views, you want to use words like I think, or I believe, or I feel, or in my opinion, because you're qualifying it by saying that's me and my understanding, all right? This is just a sample example, all right? So I'll just read this out to you very quickly. Edward Colston was a 17th century philanthropist who gave great sums of money to the city of Bristol in the UK, money he had made from slavery. By the way, this article is very, very current. If you saw the news 2 days ago on BBC, they were tossing Edward Colston's statue into the river in Manchester. So recently it was announced that there would be one less Bristol institution bearing his name. The concert venue Colston Hall, which has been a target for anti-slavery activists for decades, will reopen in 2020 with a new name. Colston's attitudes were of his time. But he was ahead of his time too, because he also founded a grammar school for girls in the city. So now, is it right to change an institution's name when cultural sensibilities change? So you see, this is very relevant. This is happening in the real world. The whole of America last year was changing the names of their Confederate leaders, or parks named after them, or battleships named after them, what they call cancel culture. So the question is that good? Is that bad? What do you think? And so on. Similarly, there are a couple of other interesting articles, which I won't bore you with right now. But again, typically you need to look at anything that's happening in the world, pose it in the form of a question, and discuss this in the class. Which brings us to grade eight, task one. So here, now this gets to be a really interesting one, because here the candidate gives a presentation to an imagined defined audience of at least 20 people on an aspect of the communication process in advertising or politics or education. And here you can look at, within that context, you can either look at styles of delivery or the vocabulary or the structure and meaning, or even the audiovisuals and imagery and sound effects. So again, you have 8 minutes to put your views across. So I want to share with you, and this is the last time I'm sharing with you, I think, how would you go about preparing for this task? Or what would a task like this look like? So let me just share my screen one last time. Sorry. Here you go. So this was one of my students doing a grade eight exam, and she decided to talk about the role of communication in advertising. So she started, of course, by defining what ad communication is. And then based on that definition, decided to pick up on these words: signs, symbols, behavior. And said for her, she chose to define her audience as talking to her fellow group students in an advertising class in college. And she said, today in the role of communication and advertising, I'd like to talk to you about the role of semiotics, which is the study of signs and symbols. And then the impact of good visual effects in advertising, and look at a case study. So she then, of course, went on to define what is semiotics, where did it come about from. She brought up the name of Ferdinand de Saussure. Then she spoke about how semiotics, beyond Ferdinand de Saussure's definition, also had another gentleman called Roland Barthes' definition, where it became not just signifier and signified, but denotation and connotation. And she then went on to explain how every symbol, all right, which is in the physical form, creates a meaning in our mind, all right? So for instance, with this particular advertisement of Dettol, she spoke about this where this lady is holding a handrail, and now for a moment, they've replaced the rail and put an actual hand. And now all of a sudden you become in contact. It's unsafe. Coincidentally, also a very relevant ad at this time sanitizing and sanitizing. And then, of course, she looked at even another ad, this funny one like this for children, lollipops. This is a sugar-free one. So it shows you how, even when it's fallen on the ground, all the ants are going out of their way to avoid it. And then, of course, she looked at another example of, let's say, Heinz. So she's highlighted certain things now. The rich redness of the backdrop, which is a color associated with food. How the bottle is sliced like ripe tomatoes, which connotes freshness and a healthy product. How they use this language over here, no one grows ketchup like Heinz, which means they've taken the word grow and transformed a factory sugary condiment into a natural ingredient. So how this is what advertising would do, all right? So it looks at vocabulary, looks at language, looks at visual imagery, and so on. And then, of course, came this very touching ad, and I want to share this with you. I'm just going to ensure that my audio is on, so just give me a second, please, while I share this with you. So this was an ad released by President's Choice, which is a big grocery brand.
Just for some, but for
everyone. So she did this, and she spoke about it as a case study. And she said how in the earlier part of it, we're seeing isolation. We're seeing what we see around us in the real world. Everybody busy, everybody's head down. And then she spoke about it and she said, well, food brings people together. And we all, of course, know that. We, of course, experience that. But sometimes we forget just how simple it can be and how these two people decided to start a revolution and changed literally by force everybody who lived in that particular floor. And of course, you saw multiple ethnicities, you saw multiple ages, you saw different food styles. And of course, they put this out. Now, the brand that put this out, what do they want us to do? So it was 150 years for Canada that year. And the sad statistic is that two out of three people in Canada eat alone. So when you look at why this ad was made, is that food brings us together. Who better than a grocery store to put it across? And then, of course, she went on to analyze what does this ad do, where she talks about it's had 11 million views, blah, blah, blah. Why did this campaign succeed? It was simple. It held attention. It had an impactful message. It educated us. There was an emotional connect. And finally, of course, there was a call to action. So you could choose to also do something like this. I'm just going to go back to my original slides. So this is what a grade eight task one could look like. Just give me a second while I readjust my screens. All right, so which brings us to a grade eight task two. Here the candidate provides a public address in response to three scenarios. These scenarios are there in your support guide. In fact, it looks like this. Sorry. Over here. So typically, what should be the scenarios? It could be, there are literally six scenarios over here. You could prepare for any of them. The examiner is going to pick out one of them. All right, so I think it's great work for you to do as a teacher and to genuinely build the skill of learning how to deliver a speech in the context of a small audience or a defined audience, and you're given the scenario. Now, the beauty of this task is that while you're halfway through it, all right, is you just make a 2-minute speech, and then the examiner will ask the candidate, the examiner will then give the candidate an adjustment to make to their speech. And the candidate will have 2 minutes to make that adjustment. So for instance, if let's say you're talking about, it was meant to be, let's say, a family reunion, and you kind of had prepared a speech for all the members of the family to be there, and suddenly two of them are stuck in traffic and another has missed their flight connection. So now, instead of doing this speech, perhaps maybe in person with everybody, now you're going to do it with in person and also with them, those who are missing it, being online. So just to, again, guide you on how to prepare for this, typically when you are preparing a speech, this is the process you'd go through from number 1 to 2 to 3 to 4 to 5. So you have a topic, you consider what your speech is about, what are you going to be talking about, who's your audience, what is your intent, you brainstorm a couple of points, and then you will make it engaging by either adding in some witticisms or story or quote or whatever. Now, that is how you deliver the first part of the task. Then your examiner is going to throw you a little bit of your spanner in the works and say, well, this is now the change scenario. So what could change in a speech? Ideally, there could be a change in the agenda or a change in the flow. Or there could be a change in the profile of who's attending or a change in the venue. Or there could be some, either an addition or a deletion or an alteration of the intent of the speech. So when you're working this in your class, you've got to factor all these things in, all right, and help build your students to have the flexibility to deal with these things, all right? So that is what is expected over there. Grade eight, task three, the candidate presents an overview of a contentious issue of their own choice, from current affairs or social media or politics to discuss, and explains both sides of the argument. Now, this, I think, is one of the most mature tasks because it's essentially like a reportage, but you're going very, very deep to analyze all sides of the situation. So typically what you should cover ideally in this is, so of course I've given you social political issue definition, and then how would you prepare for this task? So for instance, when you're preparing an issue, you must have the story, the angles, sources, quotes that make it credible on either side, and perspectives, who all are affected. So for instance, when my daughter did her grade 8, she decided to talk about STEM versus STEAM, which is basically science and math on one side versus arts and the humanities on the other side. And she went out to list, for instance, her talking points. What is the issue? Who is affected? What do people feel? And so on. And then, of course, these are some of the other probing questions that she used, right? Things like where you explore the issues. So how would you explore the issues? By following maybe these questions. And how would you get to understand interests of people, all right? Who is explaining an interest and why? And finally, of course, how would you develop options? So this task is really about conflict resolution also, where you're understanding the perspectives of people and you're understanding what it takes to get people to understand along common thinking lines, okay? So that's pretty much the end of grade 8, task 3. I'm gonna stop over here now and take whatever questions you have. It's just 2 minutes after 4. Thank you for being patient. Let me stop here. Renu, all yours.
Yes, hi. That was really, really great, Dale. I think you sort of went, you covered all the tasks and you went into a lot of detail. So that was really interesting. And there are a few questions that have popped up. This is an amazing syllabus that will work very well in a classroom language lesson. I think it would be wonderful if areas such as hate speech, gender awareness, racism, and being politically correct is added. So I just, Dale, if you could, I feel like some of that is already in the tasks. It depends on your choice, isn't it, of what you choose.
So the beauty and the relevance about a lot of Trinity subjects is about, and that's why we always say it's an authentic exam, because firstly, you choose. We just give you a guidance and say, choose a topic from social issues. So you choose whatever's close to your heart. So you can use whatever you want, literally, all right? But give it the context, give it the perspective that you need. And most importantly, ensure that the candidate has the maturity to execute it. Don't just, as a teacher, pick a smart topic, but the candidate is struggling in that area. So I leave that to you all to decide that.
Yes, and I think the same person asked a question about task 2. I think this is grade 8 because it popped up during grade 8. Grade 8 task 2, is it classic improvisation in speech and drama now used for communication skills?
No, I'd have to say not. Just give me a second. Let me be doubly sure before I answer that. Grade 8 task 2, you said?
Yes.
Oh yeah, so yes, absolutely. In so much as yes, but you're required to make a speech. These scenarios, actually this has come more out of the professional certificate in the ATCL syllabus, where you make impromptu speeches. So this is from that. And again, the improvisation is, it's not so much the improvisation as much as it's the spontaneity to be able to adapt to the audience and the situation. So it's about also not just knowing how to say it, it's also about choosing what to say. So yes, but it's an extension of that thinking.
Okay. And Delini asks, how does a candidate stand and manage his or her presentation on a laptop at an online exam?
So typically what happens is that you have the option to stand and then you share your screen and then you have a wireless clicker and you stand about 4 feet behind from the screen and so like you're audible, of course, and then you can change your slides as you go along. And then of course, when you're done with the task, you come and you stop sharing the screen. And examiners are of course prompted to use the gallery view, all right, or to use the speaker view in which they keep both the material presented as well as the candidates are both side by side in about the same ratio, so they can see them equally.
So actually, Delini, you have to send in your PowerPoint presentation to the center before the exam date so that we have it on the laptop that the candidate will be using for the exam. And then they just need to know how to do screen share on Zoom, which is quite easy to do.
That's true.
Any other questions? There were some questions which I answered the information, but it was mainly on the support guide and the text that you were talking about. Just so that everyone knows, if you download the support guide, the text that Dale was talking about for some of those tasks and having three texts, I think, they're all in that support guide. Is that correct, Dale?
Yes, absolutely. So I've just put the link back in for that. I'm also teachers. I'm going to request you once again, please, I'm sharing with you a feedback link. If you could kindly take a moment or two to share with us your thoughts, I'd really be grateful. Of course, for those of you who join us a little later, these are the links to the earlier two sessions recovering grades initial to 3 and 4 to 5. These are the YouTube links for Sri Lanka. Most importantly, teachers, you know, I'm sure that in many ways, of course, many of you know this syllabus, but for some of you who are looking at the syllabus for the first time, you're thinking to yourself, wow, this is like so relevant and so cool. I requested Renu, and we figured it would be a good thing if next Saturday as well, I'm going to touch on another syllabus of ours, which is the integrated skills in English. And you will understand, and I want to touch upon the significance of the subject, the kind of approach to this exam, the skills involved, this covers reading into writing and speaking into listening. It's one of the most difficult English assessments to do. But more than it being an exam, it is a way in which you learn to develop the language. So each level comes with its own 80 hours of what we call scheme work. All right, so there are 80 hours worth of lesson plans that you can take and develop for your classroom practice. So if you are a teacher and you teach the English language, this is now upping it for the next level of the game, because this is taking you all the way right up to the C1 level and C2 level as well. So that's a link that I've shared with you over there. If you'd like to register for that webinar next week, yes. It is next
Saturday
at 3 o'clock Sri Lankan time.
Yes, that's correct. I encourage you to sort of join this webinar, because ISC is something that is new in Sri Lanka, because a lot of teachers don't do the ISC, and it will be really useful, especially for all of you who are doing the JESSE syllabus, to take a look at our ISC syllabus. It is, as Dale mentioned, one level up from that, because it has all four skills. And this would be a really great introduction to that. There was one question, Dale, about resources. Any resources that you would be able to recommend to teachers that they can use in assisting and guiding students?
I'll tell you, one of the reasons why I chose to do my dissertation in communication skills and the topic that I chose was all about teaching communication skills, because sadly, the subject of communication covers so many academic and theoretical concepts that nobody teaches you how to do it. So there is sadly not too many resources. I mean, a lot of it, you've got to think it up. You've got to model it on behavior. And you've got to think of it from the context of, how do I take a complex task like making a speech and breaking it down into smaller parts? Maybe first start with, what is this person impassioned about? And then start with, what is the one thing that they want the world to know about this topic? And then maybe go to building their confidence by perhaps just reading aloud first, and then using a little bit of poetry or drama to bring out elements of the voice. Then again, clubbing those two. So I don't have resources or a guide to go to. And that's why we try and do these workshops once in a while to share whatever we have. But sadly, no. I'd say actually there are a lot of resources, but you'll have to kind of adapt it. You've got to find the creative and imaginative use of those things around. So there's so many of these English websites. Jaguar Paw and Newsela and a couple of others, where you can take simple things like reading news and break down the levels to the appropriate age of the reader, and then get them to talk back and use technology in that, and things like Vukaroo and whatever websites, or Quizlet or Padlets, to actually energize the teaching and learning. Because that's the other part also, is that in the pure online mode, I have to accept that it can be quite challenging to sustain energy levels when learners are young. But it's up to us as teachers to kind of, I don't know, maybe liven the space, so to speak.
Yes. And there is a question about the webinar next week. It is Saturday and not Sunday, Sharon. It's Saturday, the 19th of June. 19th is Saturday. Yes, it is. So I hope you can join us at that time. Great. I think, as Dale said, please do fill in the feedback form. That really does help us. And hopefully we'll see most of you next Saturday. Dale, thank you again. For spending another hour with us, and it looks like you're not getting rid of us anytime soon, so we'll see you back here next week.
Thank you very much. Have a lovely weekend, everyone. Bye.